This is the latest panel I've ever done. It's the longest I've ever been sober. So I just found out we don't have a moderator, so just let's start doing questions.
You're looking good.
Was that a question?
No doubt.
You're looking good. But thank you. I've been preserved since 2002. Scotch does make a good embalming fluid. Does anyone want to start off with a question? Wait, not one question? You kind of half put your hand up. Yes. Wait, that's a Heil Hitler. That's
how was it? What was it? Work for Asylum?
Oh, it was great. I've actually done now, I guess, three or four. And I don't know if you guys saw, I just worked with them again on something I'm not supposed to say. It's the third one of them. It's the, well, I can give you hints, and if you guess on your own, there's nothing I can do about it. Well, this is the third one.
Sharknado 3.
Yeah.
I can either confirm or deny my involvement. But to answer your question, no, I love working for those guys. I mean, they have a great sense of humor about them, and they know what their product is, and they make no excuses for it. And, you know, there's obviously been proven to be an audience for those types of movies. And, you know, those are the kind of movies I kind of grew up on, you know, so I really enjoy it. And my 10-year-old daughter is so, well, she's as excited as my 23-year-old son is that I could be in this movie that I can neither confirm nor deny. So yeah, they're great to work with. Thank you. Yes?
What was your most memorable experience in Stargate?
Gosh, the most memorable. Wow, there were so many of them. I think the most memorable thing, just overall, was just the camaraderie on set. It didn't matter if you were like a day player, if you were a guest star, if you were a reoccurring guest star, if you were a regular. We just had one order of the day was that you come to have fun. You know, you come prepared, but you come to have fun, and you come to laugh, and you come to not take yourself so seriously. And if you did, you would never be hired again. Like, seriously, no joke. I mean, if we had someone whose personality didn't fit, not to say that we didn't have a lot of different personalities, but one of the things was that you kind of had to check your ego, that you could not only make jokes, but you had to be okay being the butt of jokes. So you couldn't take yourself real seriously or you wouldn't last very long. So that's kind of, and working on a lot of other sets, there, my sense of humor is not as appreciated as it was on, because I have a different way of working than a lot of people. Like, I don't like the sets to be quiet. I don't like, you know, people not being able to talk to you. I don't like sitting in my trailer by myself. You know, I don't like any of that. And so I kind of bring that to sets that I work on, and you'd be surprised how many people don't appreciate it. I don't want to mention names, Simon Baker. Yeah, he had a particular dislike for me. Well, he had the misfortune of, Jay Acovone, I hope Kowalski, I was doing a guest spot on The Mentalist, and which is in no way is a reflection upon his lack of personality. But so it was like, we hadn't seen each other in a couple of years, so I'm just reading the call sheet, and it says, whatever the character's name was, and Jay Acovone. Like, there's not too many Jay Acovones in. So I went and knocked on his trailer, and, like, literally, it was like, you know, with girls seeing Justin Bieber. We were squealing, like, and so the whole time it was like we were doing Stargate on The Mentalist. And yeah, it didn't go over very well. What I identified most, just how black and white he was. There's just right and wrong. There's no gray, you know. And I'm kind of like that. You can always find reasons why something's right or not right or whatever, and then kind of convince yourself, well, that, you know, it's not really cut and dry. Well, usually it kind of is cut. that's why. But the thing that was hardest, at least in the beginning, was just him never smiling. You know, especially with how much we used to joke around on set. And in the beginning, it was, you know, everyone's job wanted to make me laugh. And you know, and it wasn't just the actors. I mean, the crew would get in on it. And so that I found in the beginning very, very difficult, because I hadn't really found who the character was yet. So it wasn't, in the beginning, I didn't turn him on and off. I was pretty much Teal'c all day, which, let me tell you, ain't that much fun. But yeah, so that's kind of what was probably the most difficult in the beginning for me. Thank you. Yep.
Before coming back to the character to do the big finish audios?
It was kind of weird, because I hadn't, you know, I don't sit around and just talk to myself in the mirror as Teal'c. So I hadn't actually done his voice in a while. I hadn't done his persona in a while. So it actually took a minute to kind of get it back. But I enjoyed it. I mean, it was like kind of revisiting an old friend, you know. So I actually did really enjoy it.
Or perhaps given anything from the set to remind you of
SG-1? Are there kids in here? How old are you? 12. Does the word shit offend you? I'm sorry, Mom. Oh, I robbed that place blind. One time I had like 20 something watches. I had like every shirt that Teal'c ever wore. I had all his hats. And then like stuff they would give me, like the, I think it was called Windwalkers, or where we wore the long trench coats. They actually gave me that trench coat. So that trench coat is the only thing I had left. I've pretty much given everything else away for charity and stuff like that. But I still have that. It was that trench coat cost them like $14,000, and to be used in one episode. And when the wardrobe designer came and gave it to me, I mean, I know what a colossal reaming out she probably got from MGM for spending on a coat and then giving it to me. So, but yeah, I mean, my prized possession though was. On the last day of shooting, I went into the briefing room and I took the flag. I can't even say I stole it, because I went and said, look, I'm going to take the flag from the briefing room, so if anyone wants to try and stop me, now we have time to do it. So that was my prized possession. And then a charity asked me if I had something to auction, and it was just a charity that I really enjoyed, and so I gave the flag to auction. So, but yeah, I mean, anything that, and the one thing that I didn't get were any of the tattoos, because they literally would guard the tattoos and any of the weapons, like the staff weapons, the Zats. They used to guard those things, like they would take inventory at night, like. Anytime we use them, because those were, you know, I don't know why they deemed those the tattoos so valuable, but But I mean, you could get the black ones that they would spray onto like the background, right? But the actual gold ones, like I tried to steal Tony's. I tried to steal Peter's, and they would have a count. And if there was one missing, they'd come straight to me. Right, and so. Well, I did, when we got done, I wrote this pilot called Rage of Angels that's still kicking around somewhere, but we developed it at MGM for, I don't know, a year and a half or 2 years or something. Then Starz bought it, and we developed it with Starz for a year and a half or so, and now there's another group that want, but I mean, it's kind of, I don't know, it's... I almost said, it's like, you know, when you have a baby and at first it's really good and then you get tired of it. Which, is that what I meant to say? But you know how when you have a baby and at first it's really cool, and then that's kind of what it was, it's kind of lost its luster for me. You know, I just don't really care about it anymore. I mean, it's, no, that's not what I'm saying about my kids. It's kind of like when you get a puppy and at first it's really cool. And then but now I kind of, there's something coming up which I'll probably start writing, but I probably want to.
Tell us.
Well, I guess the one thing I can talk about. Are you guys familiar with Infinity Blade? Anyone? It's one of the most popular iOS games ever. 50 million people bought it. So we're doing a live action version called the Infinity Blade Chronicles. So that's what we're doing now. We're in prep for it right now, and we're gonna go to camera. I think July 7th. I think is the first day of principal. So we're going to do that as a movie, and then depending on what, and we're going to release it first through the Infinity Blade store, so you actually have to have the actual game to be able to get it in the beginning. So we just want to, you know, say thank you for them buying the game, that they get it first. Was it me saying shit? Where are you going? Where are you guys going? Where are you guys going? It's only 8:20. There's still 40 more minutes of this. Are you going to pee? Are you really? No, you're not. Here, take this microphone. I don't believe you. Here. No, I'm kidding. You don't actually have to do that. And you wonder why there's guys like Charlie Sheen. So yes, we think it will be ready by I think it's February. It should be all ready to go. So our first window will be through the Infinity Blade store, and then it will be released to anyone that has an iOS device. And then the third window will be Netflix or Hulu or one of those guys. No, but I like them. I mean, it's just, but they're third. So we're very, very excited about it. I mean, just to be able to disseminate content through a non-traditional means, I think it's very exciting. I think it's very exciting to not have to get a cable package with 897 stations and you only watch four of them. You know, I think that's, we're headed into a very exciting time where we can actually control and actually have real input into the stuff that we really enjoy watching and what we want to watch, not just being fed truckloads of mass-produced crap.
Teal's not on all of them. Teal's not on any of them.
Teal's not on it? No, no. Because then they'd have to pay MGM. So no. I've done my time with them already. but yeah, it is truly a very, very exciting time for us. I'm very excited about it. And we, have this other project, Sentinels, which will be which will have a more traditional distribution, but it's a it's back to really big budget, really. You know what sci-fi? I'm sorry, I have to pontificate for a minute. When you're my age, you know, sci-fi used to be a place of wonder. We used to lead imaginations, not follow them. You know, sci-fi gave birth to so many things, and it was the genesis in so many people's imaginations of what could be. And now it's almost like all this sci-fi is these aliens come to Earth and we're fighting for our survival. You know, and to me that's, I miss the big space operas. I miss going to other worlds and hypothesizing about what life on these other worlds would be like. I'm really excited. I don't know. I guess I shouldn't be talking about a show that I'm not on, but I'm excited to see The Expanse. I mean, it's a show where they go to other worlds. You know, it's a show about exploration. The show that I'm talking about is Sentinels, which is our show. It's about the one thing. If you talk to a lot of science, one of the misconceptions about space travel and about inhabiting other worlds is the ability that is a thought that we'll immediately be able to go to these other worlds and terraform the worlds to suit our needs. Probably is not going to happen. What Sentinels is about is about the settling of these worlds, but how do you have to do it? You have to, rather than terraforming the planet, you have to genoform people. You have to change the genetics of human beings to be able to suit the singular requirements of living in these other worlds, be it lung capacity, be it density, be it your skin has to have certain qualities if you're going to be outside on these planets. That's all part of it. And so I'm really excited about that too, to actually just even suggest that rather than traditional, hey, we're going to go to Mars and build buildings. I'm very excited about that too. Just to have that, even that dialogue, even more. Remember how important it was for us to get to the moon? Remember how important it was for us to land something on Mars? It just seems to kind of subsided a bit, you know. And it's just interesting that it's starting to, people are missing that, and it's starting to come back again. So anyway, sorry, that's enough. I'll go back to silliness again. What was your question? what was the last question?
Writing credits.
It wasn't
writing.
Writing?
Writing credits. Did I? Oh, am I going to write again? Yes. So, well, kind of in a roundabout way, I kind of answered. I'm definitely going to, in the for Infinity Blade, I'll probably stay on also as an actor for however long it goes, or whatever different permutations it takes on. But Sentinels, I hopefully will be able to kind of cut back on the acting and be more of a producer and direct some of them and stuff like that. So, yeah, I'm getting old. I don't want to be in shape anymore. I don't want to diet. I don't want to work out anymore. You know what I mean? I'm tired of it. I want a Snickers. I want some red velvet cake. Thank you. Yes.
So I'm gonna be brutally honest with you. I know very little of your sci-fi career. Mm-hmm. I'm interested in if you would ever be interested in revisiting either sci-fi or Stargate or your character, or see it come back and in the future if you could have like intimate power over the world.
When you say intimate power, take this microphone. what? I'm sorry.
Ultimate.
Oh, I thought you said intimate. Great power comes great responsibility. No, I. You know, if they were gonna do, I imagine. Our 20-year anniversary, like it's the movie's 20-year anniversary this year, but I imagine in 2 years, I imagine there's going to be some sort of retrospective. And not that we would be in character or anything, but yeah, it'd be fun to kind of go back and kind of relive some of our funnier moments and goofier moments. And yeah, so that would be fun. But to actually play Tilk again, I mean, I was that guy for a very long time. And I'm truly looking forward to being someone else. I mean, they did, well, they aren't doing movies, but I don't think Tilk would be involved because he came from the imaginations of the TV writers. And I think it's no secret that, well, first of all, they would have to pay the TV writers a character fee. And I don't think there's any secret of Devlin and Emmerich's dislike of us. So I don't think that's going to happen. But yeah, I'm looking forward to the 20 year, just to have, you know, a look back at stuff. Yep.
What did you have to do to prepare physically for the role in order to bulk up and get the physical physique of
Teal? I lifted a lot. I did a lot of cardio, and I didn't eat a lot. I tried to keep my caloric intake somewhere around 900 calories a day, which it was tough at times, and especially because I still will have the odd drink, but back then I was a drinker, so it was a conscious decision where, well, am I gonna get my calories from eating or from scotch? Scotch went a lot. So yeah, it was a grind. I mean, it was during the off seasons. I would always gain somewhere between 30 and 50 pounds in the off season, and so I had basically 2.5 months to put it on, and a month to take it off. So the workouts to take it off were, I would start off with two workouts a day, two cardio sessions a day. Then I would add, the following week I would add a cardio and a weight session. Two cardios and I would add a weight session. The following week I would add another cardio. And then finally for my last week I would do four cardios a day and a weight session. So it wasn't even that the day was 24 hours. My days really worked in 2 hour increments because I would do a cardio and then sleep because I just didn't have enough energy to do anything. So I would sleep, eat a little something, do another cardio, sleep, eat something, do another cardio. And then I would have my biggest meal of the day, like around 1 or 2. And that's when I would do a weight session and then go right back to sleep. And then at night, do another cardio. So I mean it was a rough way to do it, but I just, you know, literally the week, one of the great things on our last day of shooting, we were all if not calorically limited, but also definitely certain foods we didn't eat. So on the last day they would always treat us with something, because that would be the official end of our diets. So like 1 year, they brought up, I don't know, like 8 cases of fat burgers. Our last season, they brought 12 boxes of Krispy Kreme. And so I hadn't had sugar in 9 months. So like a fool, I quickly eight or nine donuts. So you can literally see on spot during takes, I just started sweating. And literally started sweating through my clothes. And then I went to that. It was during the middle of a scene, it was just like, and I passed out. My body just couldn't take all the sugar. So that was, and we used to do it every year. That's it was ridiculous, but it was fun. I don't know. Passing out is fun. When it's not from booze, it's fun.
I was wondering, sort of two questions here. My apologies to anybody offended, but one, how do you prep for...
You know, that was very passive aggressive, because that wasn't a real apology.
Here are my questions. One, how do you prep for fight scenes like the one you did with Jason Momoa on Stargate Atlantis? also.
I'm sorry, can you say that again?
Pranks prevalent on set.
Oh, yes, yes. So your first question. Fight scenes are very much like a dance. There, you learn them the same way that you learn dance steps, because it's a dance. So what our stunt coordinator with Dan Shea would do is record video our stuntmen going through the fight. So he would walk me through and teach me the count. And so it's literally works on a musical count. It's, you're in 4-4 time. And so then I could, and I just didn't like to rehearse stunts. I mean, because it was kind of, it's just kind of the same steps, just you just kind of reformulate them. And so when I was gonna do the fight with Momoa, Bam Bam, James Bamford, who's also now the stunt coordinator on Arrow, said, hey Chris, we wanna do like the biggest fight we've ever done. And I had seen some of Momoa's stuff. And no, not that way. He's a big guy. So I was a little worried because, you know, he's a big guy. But he's also very athletic and fast and young. And so I thought, you know, well, let me see the fight. And so Bam Bam brings the videotape up, and I just sat there like, there's no way I can do this. There's no way I can do this stuff. And he said, well, you know, we can get you a stunt double. He said, I don't know, Jason's doing all his own stuff, but it's okay if you want to stunt double. So I went from never really rehearsing fights to like literally I just learned them on the day. We rehearsed for 2.5 weeks. A standard fight scene is broken up into very short increments because when you're shooting the wides, it's the stuntmen who know the entire fight scene because that's what the wide is. It's the entire fight sequence shot in one take. But that's not how actors learn their fights. You learn these very small snippets. So the most you generally have to know at any given time is about 15, 20 seconds. This fight was 7.5 minutes. And we did every take of it. So to that fight scene we shot for about 7 hours straight. You know, I've never been that tired in my life. And it came out great. I mean, we were so happy with it, and we hope you guys enjoyed it. And that's another thing, you know, that's the only reason that entire episode came about was because there was such a debate between fans about who would win Teal Girl or one of the guests. That's the only thing, they specifically wrote that episode for the fans. So thank yourselves.
You won.
Well, now would be, let me see, would Teal be Roman Dex, Khal Drogo, Aquaman, Hercules, or, you know, just like, Christ. What do you think of him being cast as Aquaman? Have you guys seen the poster?
Yeah.
Isn't that kick-ass? And let me tell you, it couldn't happen to a better kid. I don't know if you guys have had a chance to ever see him anywhere. He's one of the sweetest people I've ever met in my life. We're all so proud of him. He's just a great kid. And you're saying prank wise, yes, there were a lot of pranks that went on. I had to be up, just to give the abridged version, I had to be up generally first in the mornings. So I had a variety of stuff that I would do. I would start with, I would saran wrap people's toilets. So, you know, like in the morning, you're tired, so you just go on your trail and use the bathroom. But little you know, you lift the lid, there's still saran wrap over the actual bowl. That was one of my favorites. That's a gross show, I'm sorry. There's a thing in Hollywood, it's not just our set, it's every set. It's called turd burglar. You go break into someone's room or trailer, and you You leave them a gift and there's another one. So that was another one of my favorites. You pour milk on someone's carpet, so you rub it in so you can't see, but then there's a terrible smell. just stuff like that. You know, harmless, innocuous stuff like that. So we did have a good time. Prank wise.
So there were video games in the works for Stardew Worlds, and there's also an Android one. Did you put any work into those games? Is there a plan to finish the Android one?
I really don't know a lot about it. I went down to where they were doing the game in Arizona, and it looked like it was going to be great. And then the next thing I know, it was like they embezzled the money or something like that. don't take it from me. I mean, this is what I literally just heard the same things you guys have. Because I'm always wondering, why isn't any of this stuff ever come out? Like, why hasn't it ever? But apparently that's, and like I said, don't take it from me. I mean, look it up. And that's where I Google it, so then everything you read on the internet is true. But for whatever reason, I don't know why it's none of this stuff comes out. Because I mean, we certainly they approach us, we agree to do it, and then it's never happened. So I wish I could tell you why. I really don't know why. Sorry.
You had the scenes with Erica Durance. Are you still in contact with Michael Shanks? Would you see yourself as you kind of want to see other aspects of science fiction, maybe going to Saving Hope?
I don't know if you know, Erica's my sister-in-law. No. Yeah. Truly at this point in my, this is not to be offensive, this is not, I don't like procedurals, I don't mind. I don't enjoy doing those types of shows. I the amount of dialogue and the amount of stuff that means absolutely nothing to me as an actor than memorizing dialogue. I kind of just want to stick to like sci-fi and action and ridiculous demons. it's kind of what I have fun doing. I really don't, in any time in the near future, I really just don't see doing anything outside kind of the sci-fi fantasy genre. I mean, because truly that's what I'm interested in. That's what I like to see. A lot of it, a lot of stuff you do because either your family likes it or that's what you watch. And that's kind of what I watch. So, I mean, other than, I'd love to be on The Walking Dead. What category is that? Is it fantasy? But is it horror fantasy? Is it horror? Horror drama? Yeah. Cheesy? You don't like The Walking Dead? Really? Some people have already said that about my acting. I no secret of what a huge Game of Thrones fan I am. I would love to be on Game of Thrones. I have too many kids. I can't be away in Ireland for 9 months away from my family. So there's just, there's stuff you want to do. And sometimes you get to do it, and just other times you don't. But I've seen some episodes, and I like the show. What was that? NCIS Los Angeles. But I did it because, I wanted to work with LL. Yeah. Not because I really enjoy the show, nor those types of shows, And it's just my own personal thing. It's not, I just don't enjoy that sort of, doing that sort of work, Having said that, they ever want to do NCIS Kilk. NCIS Drew Lock. But then, you know, let me ask you, answer your second question first. I actually, after Blade 1, they were having a lot of problems making a deal with Wesley Snipes. And I was actually going to leave Stargate Season 2 to do Blade on Showtime. Yeah. It was somewhat of a contentious time. I mean, I'm glad that... They pretty much forced me to come back, but it was something that was definitely in the works. So that was kind of, I mean, I'm completely happy with how it worked out on Stargate, but that's kind of always been one of the ones that kind of got away. So I would have, and even like, but you know, it's funny now in Hollywood, I'm considered too old to be like I didn't even get seen for like Luke Cage. Didn't get seen. They literally said he's too old. I didn't get seen for Winter Soldier. They said he's too old. Just like literally, won't even let me in the room. He's too old. Well, well, there's this thing, you know, this ageism thing in Hollywood. You know, you have all these lawyers and doctors and scientists and mathematicians and so that are in their 20s. Is that in the real world?
No.
I mean, it's a bit ridiculous. You know, especially, you know, in the superhero thing, it's how many people know how old Tony Stark is? Probably very few of that audience knows what age Tony Stark's supposed to be. But they're already talking about who we're going to redo the franchise with because Robert Downey's getting too old. Right? Or who are we going to replace? Who are we going to get to be the new Wolverine? Well, the old Wolverine's still working. You know, it's a really kind of ridiculous thing that goes on in Hollywood that way. In your first question, it's weird because there's two kind of schools of thought. One is that you're already a big guy and you have to prove to them that you could act. Or you're an actor that they have to bulk up to play these roles, and will you ever get big enough or look big enough to be really thought of as a superhero? Hi. Was that, what?
5 minutes.
Oh, I didn't know there was a cap on this thing. I was just sitting here like, we're gonna be here all night. Why did you tell me that? I wanna talk faster. so there's really two schools of thought. So I'm kind of in the middle right now. I've kind of lost a lot of weight, so when I go in on stuff, they don't see me as that big guy from SG-1. But then it's a double-edged sword because when it calls to be a big guy, it's like he's not that really that big. So it's kind of, you know, and so at any time I can either be 20 pounds heavier or 20 pounds lighter. Just kind of depending on, so I kind of just stuck myself right in the middle of it to be able to go either way within, you know, 10 days notice, 10, 14 days notice. So it's just one of those things you kind of just have to be willing to do. Last one? Yeah.
I know that you've done voice work as well, being live action, so do you, like, what do you find is more fun, doing live action or doing voice work?
They're two completely separate things. And most of the voice work I've done, I've never really done with the rest of the cast. I would always just record on my own just because my schedule wasn't that flexible. But I just did, I guess I could talk about it. They're bringing, I don't know if anyone remembers the Wacky Races, Wacky Racers back in the 70s.
Oh, yeah.
We're redoing it. We're rebooting it. And so it was the first time I'd ever, like, read with the full cast, with a full cast and voiceover stuff. And they're real voiceover people, like the heavyweights of voiceover are in this. And so I rarely on sets ever really get overwhelmed. But this is one of those times where they had all these voices and they were like, you know, the voices of every popular cartoon there is. And so I was a bit overwhelmed. But it was fun though. It was like one of those, you know, the longer you're in something, the fewer opportunities there are to have a real learning experience. And it was just like being paid to be in a master voice class, you know, to watch these professionals work. So it was great. There's a less of a, obviously doing voice work, you know, you can come in unshaven, okay, no sleep, still hungover, whatever, and those all actually help your voice. So like when I know that I'm going to record, my wife knows that there's going to be scotch and cigars because it actually helps my voice. So you know, it's two completely different things. And so just right at the end, I don't know if it's what's going on in Canada right now, but in the States there's a lot of programs being cut out of kids' schools, and one of the things that got cut at my daughter's school was art. So we decided we're not going to let that happen. So my wife actually teaches the art class, and what we do is we try to get the kids, you know, whatever supplies and stuff that they need, and blah blah blah. So what I do is at the end of my talks, I always auction off a script that goes just to their art supplies and stuff. So I'm trying to do that. This is, as you can see, an actual script. That was actually a credit card number I had to scribble off. Because this script might be a lot more valuable with that. Who am I kidding? I don't have any credit. So this script is Morpheus. It was written by Joe and Paul. It was season, Morpheus was what? Season 8 or 9? Nine? So yeah, so anyone want this? I'm a great auctioneer. Yeah? $50?
60.
60?
70.
70?
80.
80? 100. Yeah. Okay, 100.
120.
What? 120. 150.
140.
What? Wait, you negotiated my divorce settlement, didn't you? 155.
155.
200. 200. Going once. 300. 300. Once. I'll tell you what. Here. Who had the 200? Come on.
Here.
So. Here, read the request.
Okay.
You do that?
Yep. Right, bring my money. Do you want your wallet? Yeah. Oh, I don't think you have enough in your wallet. Look at my wallet. It's my purse.
This is Tate, and Tate just asked where did Indeed come from. It came when in the early days, Tilk would be asked questions, and it didn't sound right to say yes, or no, or maybe. Can you think if that would have been the catchphrase? Maybe. So I went to the writers, and I said, it doesn't feel alien to just answer yes or no. And I said, okay. Think of something. Well, you're the writers. So it literally, we're just doing, I forgot, I think the first one I ever said was when O'Neill says, here's Johnny. And I say, you are not Johnny. I think that episode was the first time I ever said indeed. And then it just went from there. So, but that was the origin of it. I do have to tell you, have you guys heard? Okay, wait, let me sign. The origin of Kel Moraine was truly, in the early days, Tilk didn't have a lot of lines. So, you know, I didn't have a lot of studying to do after work. You know, it didn't take long to memorize, thank you, Odie. We'll give you that injection. So I had a lot of downtime at night, which I chose to fill.
What's
scotch? Yes. So I would get my sleep on set, and so we would have these long boardroom things and briefing room scenes where Tilk wouldn't say anything, and I would fall asleep. And I believe it was Peter Deluise's first episode that he directed, and I fell asleep during the wide shot. And I hear Deluise has a very distinctive voice, and I hear, Chris, are you sleeping? Are you sleeping? And so I immediately snapped, and I was like, no, I'm concentrating, I'm meditating. Tilk has just lost his world, his wife, his child, his people are enslaved, he's just become a turncoat. Why would I care what these people are talking about Earth stuff? I hear this, oh, okay. So I get the next episode, and they've written it in. They have now given me license to go out at night and drink and sleep on set. And that is the origin of Kel Moraine. She said, it's Serena, like the tennis player. She said, but not so, but black. And thank you. You know, like I said, this is the first 8 o'clock panel I've ever done. This is a hoot. I think I'm just gonna start. Let's do it. Let's do an 8 o'clock panel tomorrow night. Thank you all so much. You really have a great weekend. This is the best Friday I've ever seen anywhere. So thank you all so much, and have a great, great weekend.